purpose and a goal for His people. And I believe when you look in the book of Revelation, you find that the climax of everything that God has said and what He wants for our lives is summed up in this book, because He plainly declares one thing for surety, that He wants life and life more abundantly. For John 10:10 says that thief cometh, amen, but to kill and to steal and to destroy. But that Jesus came to give life and give life more abundantly. So His purpose and His goal is to give life. You see, they're witnessing revivals overseas in some of the demon-possessed countries of our world. In the demon-possessed countries overseas, where devils are being cast out, and where people are gaining the victory, and where witchcraft and idolatry is so prevalent, it seems to be that God is working and moving overseas in those countries and bringing deliverance, amen, to those people. While in the country of America, it seems to be that witchcraft and idolatry and demon possession has become more prominent in our country. And we're seeing a rise of different things that are taking place in our country that lets us know how much we need the power of God and how much we need life. And I believe that the essence of what God is trying to say in everything that He does, His intention for man, His desire for man, is that they can have life and they can know life forever and ever and ever and ever. And it can keep on going. And this is the purpose of God for every one of us, that we can have life. The ultimate triumphant of Christ is given in the book of Revelation. It's a hallelujah life of victory. It's a life that cannot be corrupted. It's a life that is brought to light. Amen. Amen. It's a life of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ that gives us hope in the midst, amen, of difficulty. So we find it ends in the book of Revelation in giving us victory and giving us life. You see, in the very first book in the Bible, we find that man was driven from the garden. Amen. And he lost that life eternal. He lost out with God. And the seraphims kept them out of that garden. And that in that process, amen, the scripture tells us, amen, that there was death, amen, in the human race. And all plunged in to death. I want to tell you, what did God do? God chose to take a group of people, a world of people that was dragged down into sin and chaos, and pick them up and make them a new person. Amen. To make them a new individual. That's what He chose to do. He chose to make you a new person. Hallelujah. He didn't destroy you. He picked you up and made you a new creature in Christ Jesus. That's what the gospel did for you. Amen. We said we're new creatures in Christ. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. What happened? He made you a new creature in Christ. All things passed away. That's what the grace of God and the power of God has done for you. So the central theme in the Bible was life. Hallelujah. Because God, hallelujah, chose. If you look throughout the Bible, you see, amen, that death came. Oh, yes, over and over, death came. It's divided throughout the Bible. Hallelujah. When you see it in the first three chapters of the Bible, you see that tree of life that they once enjoyed. Amen. You see it now closed off. And man, hallelujah, has lost out with God. And man no longer has the benefits. He's violated life of God. And now he's chosen to walk in his own way. And then you see all throughout the Bible, amen, that in Deuteronomy, you see the children of Israel as they go through that wilderness, as they followed God, as they followed Him, there was life available to them. But then they chose, amen, to walk in their own pathway, and they chose to follow their own. All the great feast and the sacrifices and the assembling together of the people, amen, were all letting us know that God was providing life. But what happened is they chose to go the wrong direction. They chose to follow their own route in life. And that life that they could possess was no longer their possession. Can I tell you something today? Life is at your fingertips in Christ Jesus. But that's the only life, amen, that will enable you to live forever and walk forever in the presence of God and to know Him, amen. I tell you, I want to walk with Him all the way home. Don't you? We find the prophets. We find the prophets in the Bible. We find Isaiah and Malachi. We find them as they would not heed the warnings of God that offered them life. Offered them life. They were able to receive life. But yet, with all the prophets prophesying, they turned their backs upon the life that God had offered them. And the appeal of the prophets, amen, they went wrong. They went their own direction. And they forfeited their life. They forfeited life that God had provided for them. Folks, listen. We're forfeiting the blessings. But then it all points to a real life that comes in the cross of Jesus Christ. It tells us that there's a cross. Because the Bible of God, even the temple of Ezekiel, lets us know that there's a river that is flowing, and there is redemption that is provided, and that God has given us life, and life more abundantly, that the Lord has made a provision for us, amen, and provision for the church that we could live, praise God, with Christ, and that we did not have to reject the truth. The cross is not just a doctrine, but it is an operative force in our life. It is an operating reality in our life. It is something, thank God, that is not just a mere thing. It is a real thing that takes place in our life. And that cross and the blood of Jesus Christ is the answer to your dilemma. It's an answer to your problem. It's an answer to what you need in your life today. It's because of the cross. God forbid, hallelujah, that I should preach anything else except the cross of Jesus Christ. For it's the power of God unto salvation to them that believe. The cross is still powerful, folks. The world doesn't want it, and many in the church doesn't want it. But the power of the cross is what leads people, hallelujah, into victory in their lives. Gives you a new man. Oh, hallelujah, gives you a new birth. Ephesians tells us that we're made alive. The cross flows through. The blood flows through. We're made rich by the grace of God, by the riches of His glory. We're made powerful. Why? Because, hallelujah, of the blood of Jesus Christ to overcome the fiery darts of Satan. Oh, listen to me. We go into the Gospels and we see, too, also that John said, I must decrease and he must increase. It was an increase of God that in the Gospel that made the difference. That river flowing, amen, in the heart, in the life, was making the difference in the lives of his people. Listen, he comes to the book. Amen. I was looking in the book of John. 40 times life is mentioned in the book of John. It must have been a particular subject that was needful because you and I are in a world, amen, of darkness. Did you know what the devil really hates in the life of a Christian? Do you know what he really hates in the church? Do you know what he really doesn't like in this world? He doesn't like life. I'm not talking about something that makes you sinful lively, but I'm talking about something that makes you holy lively. You're pure in your heart and your thinking and your desires to follow him. There's a new aim and a new purpose. This is the intent of God for your life. Hallelujah. Amen. I had no place for God in my life. But when I found out I needed something above everything else, I surrendered it all to Jesus. And I found out that what I needed was only in him and through and by him. He isn't just the Lord of our life or the Savior of our life. He's the Lord of our life. He's the Lord of our life. There's a lot of people that have him as Savior, and that's as far as they ever go. But he's not just the Lord of our life, a Savior of our life, rather. He's the Lord of our life. In other words, he's the King of our life. He's the King of our will. He's the King of our desires. He sits on the throne of our hearts. He's the Lord. Amen. The scripture emphatically states, praise God, that he is the Lord of our life, not just the Savior. There's a lot of people that want him just as Savior, but that's as far as they go. But God is the Lord, amen, of your life. He's the Lord of everything you are. He possesses everything there is in your life. Every move you make, every step you take, it's all in Christ Jesus. He's the Lord of your life. Did you hear what I'm saying today? Folks, he isn't just the Savior. He's the Lord of your life. He hates it. There's no life on these pews. The life is not in these pews. Life is in the individuals that's sitting on these pews. Life is not in this building. It's in you. That's where the life of Christ is. It's in you. Hallelujah. That's what the devil hates when you wake up in the morning and you've got the life of Christ in you and you promote his will and his mercy and his grace. That's what the devil hates. He doesn't like, amen, life that flows in you and through you. Thank God. He wants to see you dead as a doornail. He wants to see you with no life, with no hope, with no purpose, and no goal. He wants to see you going through life in misery and woe. He wants to use every tactic he can to destroy you and drag you down and pull you and homes and families and friends. He wants to bring everything he can to you so you won't have life. He wants to detour you and cut you out and cut you short so that there's no life in you. He wants to sap the very life out of you. That's exactly what the enemy wants to do. But I'm here to tell you, everything that the gospel has given, hallelujah, it is to make life, amen, inside of you. Every altar, every throne, everything that God has purposed in your heart, has God given it. Oh, hallelujah. He wants you to have new life. And life more abundantly. Oh, listen to me. The rejection of Bible authority today has caused us to not have life. It's caused us. We're serving God today because, hallelujah, of his life, Brother Jimmy. It's his life within us. We live because of him. Amen. When we find he's all everything we need, we can find the victory we need. In Acts, we find the throne of God. God put on the throne. He introduces the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the power of the Pentecost in power to overcome with a river flowing in and a river flowing through. In Romans, we find the message, amen, of recovery. You find the message of life. You find the message of life. He said, reckon yourself to be dead but alive. Reckon to be dead. That means to count yourself dead but be alive. I'm telling you today, We live in a day that people, amen, will not accept the sanctified life, to die to the things of this world, to die out, amen, to the fact, amen, if they're not going to live, they need to be cleansed and sanctified and made pure and made holy. You can't live your own life and enjoy the blessings of life. You can't follow your own ways and have the ways of life. It's going to take a life of death for Jesus. It's going to take a life reckoning yourself to be dead. But he said not only to be dead, but to be alive in Christ. We're alive forevermore. Paul says it this way. We're crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet it's not I that lives, he said, but it's Christ that liveth in me. And the life which I now live in this flesh, he said, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. We live not by, amen, who we are and what we are. We live by Christ Jesus who loved us and gave himself for us. We're alive in Christ Jesus, hallelujah. And we have hope in the midst of a world, amen, that doesn't know what direction they're going. He turned us up from upside down to right side up. He made our lives different. Why? Because he chose, hallelujah, to give us life. He put life. He's living inside of me. Amen. I was dead, but now I'm alive in Christ Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. You don't live in the childishness of this old world. You live by growing up. You live by growing. You live by growing. I said, a baby lives by growing. A baby lives when he grows up. He learns something. He finds something. Amen. I'm going to grow in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? But Peter said, grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord. There's too many babies. Too many children that have never not growing up in the Lord. They're not seeking the Lord. Amen. One man said, I don't mind giving you a bottle, but he said, I hate to remove those false teeth from you. Amen. I'm telling you, folks, that we need to understand one thing. Hallelujah, that God has given us, amen, a blessing. Amen, of growth. He wants us to grow. He wants us to grow. He wants us to move forward. What does it make the difference? The answer is simple. The answer is in the active reality of the cross. It means that the cross makes an indelible difference in our lives, that we're not the same once the cross is applied to our hearts. It means that everything is different. Why? Because Jesus is alive within us. All things, amen, are different. What does it mean? It means there's an act of sovereignty, that God has control of every issues of life, and he's the Lord of my life. He's the Lord, and he wants me to be practical in my life, in my everyday living, in my everyday talking, in my everyday acting, in my everyday attitudes. He wants me to be what he's called me to be. That's what he wants us to be. He's letting me know that the issue of knowledge, that he wants me to grow up, hallelujah, and be like him. He wants me to know. He's provided knowing. Jesus, hallelujah. Praise God that we might know him, the only true living God, living Savior. He wants us to know him. He wants us to face him. And we find, amen, that he come. But then we come into the triumphant message in the book of Revelation. Then we come to the message of what he has given us and what he's climaxed our life with. Boy, that puts you on heavenly ground. Because it lets you know that God has given you something. Praise God. That is true. He's given you something. He's given me an eternal home. I have a home. Folks, I have a home. Hallelujah. Apostle John saw this city coming down from heaven, out of heaven, as a bride. Praise God, adored for a husband. The angel showed John the bride, the Lamb's wife, in her final condition, in her their magnificence, his eternal glory alive in his eternal glory. He saw a real city. Thank God, a perfect system. We don't have it here. It's the city named the Holy City, the New Jerusalem, called Jerusalem, enduring city. Amen. Constructed by God. Not one hand of man will ever construct anything on that city. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place, I'm going to come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. It is of celestial origin. It is direct product of the almighty hand of God. Hallelujah. He's the builder and he is the maker. Praise be to God. No architect, no workman but himself will build this city. It has the amplitude, it has the room that is needful. Hallelujah. Amen. For those that are born again and those that are washed in the blood and those that are saved. Oh, what a promise he has made. You see it coming down, hallelujah, to the earth, and is tended to have a near relation to the earth, but it doesn't come down to the earth. Jerusalem is above, hallelujah, according to what God said. It's clear and it's bright, praise God, as transparent icicles in the sunshine, described having the glory of God. What a place. What am I talking about? I'm talking about a place of future, my future home, my future life, my future. Amen. I lost in the garden. Hallelujah. But I'm going to regain. Praise God. There's something God's going to do. Oh, there's 12 openings of gateway with the 12 gates. End of those 12 gates is made up of solid pearl. Oh, listen to me. Oh, praise God. Streetways is gold. Transparent gold. Nothing but pure gold. I don't have to have the gold here because I know I'm going to a city. Hallelujah. Whose builder and maker is God. Folks, the world feels sorry for me over and over again because I don't indulge in their sinful practices and I don't want what they've got to offer. But I've got news for you. Amen. I tell you what, they can feel sorry all they want to, but I found out that I've got something, hallelujah, that is real. I've got a future home. Amen. Praise God. A future home, eternal home. 15 miles in every direction. 15 miles in every direction. Amen. Listen to me. There's not a place on this earth that could have a foundation like that. You couldn't build nothing on this earth. A foundation like that place is. You hear what I'm saying? No way you could build it. No, there isn't a place here that you could build. Amen. The measurements are as wide as they're long. Length and breadth and height are all equal. Everything's equal. The streets over the streets and the city and the stories over the stories and long solid cube of golden construction, 15 miles in every direction. Man, I tell you what, that's enough to make anybody shout. What has God provided for us? It has been said, hallelujah, that if you could stretch this New Jerusalem out, it would go from Florida from Maine, right on up to the Maine Father's Part, amen, and also from Atlantic to Colorado. From Atlantic to Colorado. That's pretty good size, isn't it? And it would cover Britain, Ireland, and it would cover France, Spain, Italy, Germany, Austria, Prussia, European Turkey, and half of European Russia taken together. Oh, earth has no foundation. I want to say it again, which such a city could be kept, built. Amen. I'm here to tell you, church, that we've got something. You say, well, what does that mean to me? What does that mean? It means that there's going to come a time, a perfect life. Hallelujah, with Christ Jesus. It means the system that they have, what kind of system they're going to have to light up that place. It's a system of illumination. It ain't going to be a light, amen, with light bulbs that can go out. It's going to be a light that is lit by the Lamb. Hallelujah, God, by the light of God. Amen, the Lamb of the temple. A temple. Amen. Amen. We'll lack a temple there. We won't have a temple. Amen. There'll be no temple. Why? Because the Lamb and themselves is the temple. Amen. The temple of God. For the Lord God, all the rulers and lambs, is in its temple. The worship there is immediate. Amen. You can go right straight to the blessings, the throne room of God, and you can worship the Lord. Amen, from the very depth of your heart. What is it relation to you today? Hallelujah. It means that it's beautiful. Praise God, praise. For the great King. It's great for the King. And it is superlative in holiness. It's going to be a holy place. Oh, dear friend, can't you see it now? How beautiful heaven must be. But what is it that's going to make the difference also? Is that we're going, amen, praise God. I have a wonderful tree. A wonderful tree, a more beautiful tree. A tree of life. What a charm to the world. But here we find Eden had its glad and glorious tree. But the tree of life is going to be, was in the midst of that garden. But now it was not able. Amen, to provide, because those that were pushed out, those that were moved away from the tree of life, now, amen, through the cross and the blood of Jesus Christ, are going to be able to come again to the tree of life in the midst of hallelujah, paradise. Praise God, because man was innocent and keeping, amen, and preserve his life by eating of its fruit. That was a symbol of the first tree. That was a symbol of life. It was a symbol of hope. They could eat from that tree. God's people are going to enter in, and they're going to have a tree to the tree of life, to a fruit-bearing tree. Fruit-bearing tree. You say, will you be hungry? I don't know whether you'll be hungry or not, but you'll still be able to eat. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. That's right. Amen. Because it definitely tells us that they're going to be eaten. Amen. They're going to have eaten. So in that city, in that place, in that land where we enter in, there's going to be fruit on that tree. Fresh fruit. Amen. You talking about fruit that you can't imagine. It's going to be on that tree. Can you think about a tree, amen, of life, and yet you were turned aside from eating of that tree in the garden. But now, if you've been saved and washed in the blood of the Lamb of Calvary, you say, well, that's in the future, Brother Kenneth. I don't know how close that future might be, amen, to what God's got for me. But I know one thing for sure, that I'm within doorsteps, amen, hallelujah, of seeing Jesus. And I want to be able to see him in perfect peace and enjoy the presence of the Lord. These fruits are yielded every month, each month with a new variety. Folks, what a the glorified saints are going to eat in heaven. Hallelujah. Yes, amen. Oh, they can still eat, although they don't have to eat, need to eat. They can still eat. Hallelujah. You say, well, that's a mysterious thing to me. I know it is, but I'm here to tell you one thing. Hallelujah, that Jesus ate after his resurrection. He had a glorified body. He ate after his resurrection. If he had a need to eat, then I can go ahead and eat. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to tell you, the apostle informs us that sin and its consequences will never enter that city. And that is what is so wonderful, that all the sin and corruption in this world that you see on every side, amen, everything that is clamoring, amen, for allegiance, amen, they want their rights. We want our rights. There's people in the church today that want their rights. They want to teach Sunday school. They want to be front runners, amen, in the spiritual things, and yet don't know God, don't know anything about the plan of salvation. Did you know the world today, amen, is governed in the church? The carnality of the church today, hallelujah, is ruling and reigning in most churches. And we need to understand one thing, that the spiritual man isn't reigning. The church is going down. The only hope we've got is spirituality and life in Christ Jesus. The only hope the church has is for it to catch fire. Hallelujah. With the Pentecostal power, we can't make it without it. Hallelujah. We've got to have the power and the anointing of God. Church, we can't do it. I don't care how many forums you have. I don't care how many programs you have. If there's no power in the midst, if there's no anointing in the midst, no life in the midst, nothing can happen. It's going to take God's power. Oh, the apostle informs us, behold, I make all things new. All things new. And he said unto me, write. For these words are true and faithful. I want you to know, church, that we're in for a great surprise just around the corner. What we lost in the garden, amen, what we were shut off from, if you get in this altar and you'll ask for mercy, but if you violate the laws of God, if you violate the Spirit of God, if you violate the call of God, and you violate what God says belongs to you in order to be saved, folks, you've thrown everything out down the drain. You're not going to go anywhere but to an eternal hell without God. I'm telling you, It is not a delightful thought. But there are people that sit in churches that never make a move because they never hear. The very beginning when they were moved out of that garden and that cherubim was put at that gate and they violated the laws of God, life was forfeited. Not only then and there, but down through the ages when the prophets preached and people didn't hear and walked away and said, this is not the way I want to go. They violated the law of God. Death. Death came. Death came. Throughout the Word of God, throughout the Gospels, when people walked away from God, they walked away and death was on their trail because they refused the gift of God. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Church, we're walking away. I don't care how big you are, how little you are, how much you know. We're walking away from the very thing that God intended for his people to have, and that was life. And we have forfeited that life by going our own way, because he said, there is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the end therein is the ways of death. You think you're right, but you got to know. The Bible says we're to know, hallelujah, God. And you can't know him unless you come for a practical experience and follow him. Listen, not only did in the Gospels, but in the epistles, there there was life that was offered. Death. Death came. Death came when men chose sin in their life. God forbid that I should sin. Sin is destructive, folks. Sin isn't a plaything. It isn't a play toy. People are playing around with sin. The very thing, if you knew the enormity of your sin that you commit, you'd never want to, you'd plunge in that fountain. And you'd say, God, this is it. I know. You say, do you really know? But I know, because I was one of them. And I plunged in that fountain because I said, I'm tired of it. And I meant it. I was tired. I was tired of sin the rest of my life. And I plunged in. I give him every sin. I give him my old past life of playing music for the world. I give him my old past life of desiring the things of this world. I give it all to him. And he put a new man, a new life within me. That seed of God was planted in my spirit. And that seed come forth. And it brought life. That seed of the gospel can bring life to you today. It can bring hope to you. But you can walk out and you can miss it. Folks, it doesn't matter how many times, amen, you've been baptized. It doesn't matter how many times you've gone through the rituals. It's time to think about it. About your soul. About, in closing, one final note that's going to happen. And that is, the scripture said, they going to serve him. His servants shall serve him. Did you know that's one thing you're going to do? You're serving sin today. But folks, let me tell you, a child of God that serves God is going to serve God right on and right on and right on. Because his administration is going to be an administration of complete obedience. Of complete obedience. Heaven's not going to be a place of rebels. Rebels are not going to be found in heaven. People that want to go their own way. People want to follow their own devices. Heaven is going to be a place of complete obedience and loving devotion to Jesus Christ. No more sin, no more rebellion, no more forgetfulness or neglect of the claims or the word of the eternal King. No more. It's going to be all life permeated with divine will, which when done, it will be as on earth as in heaven. What a day. What a day, the climax of the Christian life really is. What God does he intend for me? What does God desire and aim and purpose for my life? He purposes me to live now and forever with him. You can't take this life out of a Christian. Amen. I've heard people say, well, I'm afraid he'll not heal you. The only way he can take the life out of you is for you, amen, to commit to a place of saying, I don't want you, Lord, anymore. I don't desire you anymore in my life. But as long as you desire him, as long as you want him, as long as you want to go to heaven with all of your heart, I tell you, it's going to be a glorious time. I want to ask you a question today, and I'm going to close. Hallelujah. Are you, praise God, one of those that can say, Brother Kenneth, I've got life in me today. The life of Christ. The life of Christ. I know him. He lives inside of me. He lives. Can you say that? I want you to stand. Amen. Can you say he lives? Here's what I want you to do this morning. How many in this building today doesn't have life inside of you, the life of Christ? How many doesn't? Life of Christ in me. I haven't accepted His life. Amen. But I want to. Would you right now just lift a hand? I'm not living the life. Paul Harvey made this statement, said, if you don't live it, you don't believe it. He made it plain. The Word of God is plain. How many in this building want life and life more abundantly? Here's what the Scripture said that I read to you this morning. Amen. And here's what it said. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I'm alive forevermore. Amen. And had the keys of hell and of death. I want you to come right now around this altar. Everybody that would. Everybody that would. Would you step out? Amen. Would you come? Everybody. Everybody.